Tonight, from ancient times to the present, prophets claiming special powers have surprisingly predicted similar events. This strange and awesome ability to foresee what might come has always fascinated and frightened mankind. Now, learn where these prophets claim to have discovered their profound knowledge. Some say they've traveled in time, while others claim ancient secrets can unlock the door to the future. Witness the most fateful predictions. Predictions that may soon come to pass. Join David McCallum as we journey to new visions of the future.
The clock is ticking, and time may be running out. Over the centuries, prophets have seen the close of this millennium as the end of time as we know it. Some trace the warnings back to the prophets of the Bible. Others find evidence in the Book of Psalms. And then there are voices alive today, from mystics and visionaries, seemingly blessed with supernatural insight, to the more common seers, ordinary men and women. Some of them forever changed after a brush with death. But whatever the source, the prophecy remains the same. Something cataclysmic seems headed in our direction. Is our world doomed by fate? Or is the future conditional? The answers may come sooner than we think.
From ancient Babylonia to modern-day America, people have searched the heavens for answers to the past, present, and future. Very few have ignored its power. Astrologer Henry Weingarten.
Certainly many financial leaders from J.P. Morgan on have used astrology quite successfully. And there's a saying that was attributed to him, millionaires don't use astrology, billionaires do.
Astrologer Edward Heelan.
An astrologer can look ahead and pinpoint dates that things don't happen, say whether it's 95 or 97 or 2010. For instance, we can look ahead to the year 2000 and say whatever president's elected in the year 2000 will not finish their term.
Astrologer Richard Houck.
I have determined the date of my own death, and I can tell you it'll be September 13th, 2031, when I'll be 84 of a stroke.
Astrologer Thomas Sears.
My accuracy in astrology is 90 to 95%. I can prove it. So I don't worry about it. When I make a statement, I've well-researched it. Well-researched.
Astrological forecasts are based on where the planets are during a particular event. Each time an event occurs, it's compared to planetary patterns.
The important thing to remember is it always has to be anchored in a chart. Has to be anchored in an accurate chart, a chart with a date, time, and place of birth, all of which are exactly accurate. Now, countries have charts, politicians have charts, and so on.
Throughout history, leaders from around the globe have relied on the stars for guidance.
Hitler, for example, in World War II, as soon as he ascended to power, he banned astrologers and did not allow them to function in Germany. He immediately went out and hired 6 astrologers that he used for his own purposes. In the area of the United States, it's very interesting. I mean, a lot of people don't realize, for example, that Benjamin Franklin, he was an astrologer, and he supposedly elected the inauguration moment for George Washington.
There's no question in my mind that the success of the Reagan administration was in large part due to the services that they used of Joan Quigley, who was their astrologer. For 7 years, nothing went wrong. She was allowed to choose the time things started, which made them much more successful.
From world leaders to corporate boardrooms, astrology has had influence. And for years, the world's financial power base has sought advice from the stars.
It was published in the New York Herald at the time that J.P. Morgan and Vanderbilt were using astrologers, which they both admit they did. And who can argue with success?
Not that only J.P. Morgan did, but the J.P. Morgans of our day do it. And the very wealthiest people, and I don't mean just wealthy people, I mean the very wealthiest people, the really rich money, do use astrologers.
I would say out of the Fortune 500 stock market companies, at least 300 of them are using astrology. Shall we say, under the table.
We know, for example, the richest man in Hong Kong who pays his astrologer $4 or $5 million a year uses it quite extensively. We do know a number of Asian companies, a number of Indian companies that use astrologers quite heavily.
Henry Weingarten consults with large companies on when and where to move their money. Corporate decisions based on the position of the planets.
We work with technical traders that use my astrology timing and market themes as a secondary opinion. On many days, we're moving in excess of $50 million worth of commodities and so forth.
Henry Weingarten's client base is confidential. Shareholders might be shocked to learn, however, that frequently behind boardroom doors sits an astrologer.
People who are on the staff who are financial astrologers don't have the title financial astrologist, but rather than having titles like executive astrological analyst, they have titles like senior investment banker, or chief trader, or senior investment advisor.
The speed at which financial markets operate has brought the age-old practice of astrology into a computerized 20th century. Astrological forecasts are now more precise and accessible than ever before.
Now we have the computers, we just throw information into the computer, it pumps out an astrological chart. 2 seconds for us, right? There's quite a few calculations that you have to go through. Putting all the planets in the right space.
The use of computers has revolutionized astrology because 100, 200 years ago, professional astrologers never calculated horoscopes. Their students did. Their time was too valuable. Their time was used in interpreting horoscopes, and their students did all the calculations.
With more time spent analyzing charts, astrologers can possibly look deeper and deeper into the future. However, not all of what they see is appealing, as every chart has its dark side.
Astrologers oftentimes will run across a chart that I guess by somebody's definition you might call terrible. If you have a correct chart, it is possible to predict the date of death for most people.
While astrologers claim that most people don't want to know the date of their own death, there are exceptions. Yet astrology, as with any other profession, has its own set of rules.
You don't discuss death with anyone. You don't discuss the time of dying, you don't decipher the time of dying, and you don't ever tell them when they're going to die.
Many astrologers believe that the knowledge of death doesn't necessarily promote life.
Astrology, to me, is like a handbook of life. It gives you a better shot at getting more out of it. It gives you a better shot at living it better. And I'm talking about living, not dying.
What about the closing years of this century? What about Mother Earth's future? What can astrologers tell us of the coming years?
So I think over the next 10 years, there's really only going to be two key phenomena that occur. The first one will happen on January 25th of the year 2002, when we will have a very big stock market crash. That's a Friday. And the other will happen in the early summer of the year 2004, which will be even a much more powerful phenomena. And I would see that as most likely being associated with the land mass issues in the United States.
It's going to stop before the year 2000. You're going to see a lot of things occurring. And 96 is sort of the key year as far as the West Coast of America is concerned. They're going to start doing a lot of rocking and rolling. In the Midwest, what's going to happen is you'll get the flooding first, and then you'll get it receding and staying in certain areas so that you can kiss Louisiana goodbye. You can kiss a whole big slice of Texas goodbye. And I'm looking for a good-sized quake in New York City. That's going to be even more devastating than California. Careful.
Much of what astrologers see is symbolic. A chart doesn't necessarily pinpoint an exact event.
It doesn't have to be just an earthquake. It can be an earthquake in our educational system or earthquake in our financial system. Yes, there will be more earthquakes.
Do we have a choice? Are we at the mercy of the planet's positions? Or do we have control over our destiny? For the better or worse?
There's a general impression throughout Western society that astrologers think that planets cause things. Planets don't cause anything at all. What you do when you're trying to do a proof is you go back and you just look, in, like you do any scientific proof, is you're looking for pattern. See, astrology can't say what people are going to decide. People have free will.
The choice that astrology gives you, it's like saying it's raining. Your choice is whether you want to have an umbrella or a raincoat. You can get wet or not. The purpose of astrology is to forecast things so that you can deal with them.
Wars have been fought over it. Martyrs have died for it. It has survived the rise and fall of civilizations. Every day, in many languages, countless millions find comfort and solace in its pages. And it is such a little book, the Bible.
Many believe prophecy can be found within the pages of the Bible. They say the book of Revelations foretells the end of the world. And if prophecy is to be found there, perhaps it can be found in other books of the Bible. Each of the Psalms may predict events in the 20th century. Many have seemingly already occurred. Others may soon come to pass. Two biblical researchers believe they have found prophetic messages hidden within the book of Psalms. Author J.R. Church.
I had always thought that the Psalms were the simple songs of an ancient Jewish culture. Little did I know that they contained incredible prophecies, a literal guide to the 20th century.
Co-researcher and author Gary Stearman.
My initial reaction was there is no way this is true. This cannot be true. Until I went and studied, and I saw that it was absolutely, irrefutably true.
These researchers believe the Psalms predict events such as the rise of Hitler and another dictator in the Middle East, and that each psalm corresponds to each year exactly. For example, Church believes Psalms 39 through 45 prophesied the plight of the Jewish people during the Second World War.
Psalm 44 is the most heart-wrenching of the Psalms, describing the Holocaust of the Jews in those death camps during those years. Thou hast cast off and put us to shame. Thou makest us a reproach to our neighbors. Yea, for thy sake are we killed. All the day long we are counted as sheep for the slaughter. In verse 17, God says to the victims of the Holocaust, I will make thy name to be remembered in all generations. From that day to this, the world has never been able to forget what happened to those victims.
Psalm 48, absolutely startling when you consider this is the psalm of Israel's statehood, 1948. In verse 12, walk about Zion, mark ye well her bulwarks. Here's an instruction to the leaders of Israel saying, go around Zion, go around Jerusalem, discover your ancient past, which is now buried in the sands of time.
Don't only describe the historical past. According to Church and Stearman, the Psalms seem to foretell of current events.
Psalm 91 is one of the most remarkable Psalms in Scripture, for it describes in some detail the events of 1991 and the Gulf War. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness. There was the fear that those Scud missiles contained chemical warheads. And yet God says, don't worry about them. And then he goes on to say that Israel is not going to get involved in this war. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. This psalm was so remarkable that it became the favorite song of the soldiers in the desert.
If Church and Stearman are correct, maybe there is hidden meaning in Psalm 93 as well.
Psalm 93 only has 5 verses in it. But verse 3 says, the floods have lifted up, O Lord, the floods have lifted up their voice, the floods lift up their waves. In 1993, there were floods unprecedented in history all over the world, not only in the upper Mississippi, but in Europe, in the Far East, in Africa. These floods all over the world seem to be a fulfillment of this prophecy.
Are these merely coincidences, or could it really be this century the Psalms describe?
When you have 95 Psalms to date that are in chronological order, you get a pattern here that is so overwhelming that one must admit that it is this century to which the psalmist was referring.
But what of our future? Church and Stearman believe the Psalms hold clues.
Once we come to Psalms 101 through 107, we have what appears to be a period of tribulation. Psalm 101, for example, indicates that God will early destroy the wicked out of the land. This word early means at daybreak, at the crack of dawn. And of course, if Psalm 101 represented the year 2001, it would indeed be the dawning of the new millennium.
But past the millennium, then what? The Bible contains only 150 Psalms. If Church and Stearman are correct and each Psalm corresponds to 1 year, this roadmap of prophecy may dead end in the year 2050.
Reportedly, believers by the thousands journey to Venezuela to seek the blessings of a visionary. The sick come in need of healing. Others may hope to witness a miracle. Visionary Maria Esperanza appears to be the vortex for a whirlwind of supernatural events.
Deep within the forests of Venezuela lives a woman who claims to see apparitions of the Virgin Mary. Maria Esperanza is a wife, a mother, and grandmother, and by some accounts, touched by the divine. Producer-director Drew Mariani.
She's a prophet, she's a healer. She has the gift of bilocation, the ability to read souls.
Author Michael Brown.
If half of what they say about her is true, she's one of the major mystics, not just of our time, but of any time this century. A woman who has prophesied on any number of occasions events that have taken place in exactly the fashion she said.
On one occasion, she had prophesied to a group of pilgrims standing there. She saw two very large towers in a city, and she feared for what was to happen to these towers. A few weeks later, the bombing of the Twin Trade Towers took place. She has prophesied the deaths of the past three popes. I was in her presence during one apparition where she saw a terrible earthquake take place. About a month later, she described it to me. During the World Series, an earthquake rocked California.
Maria claims visitations of heavenly beings began at an early age.
Her first apparition took place when she was age 5. At age 14, St. Teresa the Little Flower appeared to her, a brilliantly red rose, and she threw this rose to Esperanza. Instead of catching the rose, something pricked her right hand, and it began to bleed. This was the onset of the stigmata.
As an adult, these alleged supernatural manifestations were to be witnessed by many.
Blood will erupt on her palms while she's praying the Stations of the Cross on Good Fridays. On one occasion, two doctors accompanied her and actually were there when the blood started to come from her hands. They weren't able to explain it.
Her son-in-law one day saw Maria kneeling in prayer. Suddenly her head went back, she stuck her tongue out, and before his eyes, a host materialized on her tongue. The bishop himself has witnessed such phenomena.
One of the most remarkable testimonies come from her children. One of her daughters said that she saw a light reflect on her mother, and her mother rose in levitation, her feet actually off the ground at that time.
All sorts of phenomena takes place. A mysterious fog that appears out of nowhere. Rose petals fall from the sky. The odor of roses are said to surround her. She's a woman that has blessed with many mystical gifts and charisms.
Of all her alleged gifts involving roses, one phenomenon is truly unbelievable.
It's just bizarre. I mean, it really is an incredible phenomenon. It's very, very hard to accept. The presence of medical doctors who have written sworn testimony to what they've seen. A rose, a budded rose, came through her chest and opened up. It was a brilliant, beautiful red, even touched with dew, almost as if though it was freshly picked.
Drew Mariani claims a personal encounter with Maria's supernatural gifts. Reportedly, it happened during a video interview that he conducted with Maria at her home in Venezuela. He witnessed a bilocation, a being in two places at the same time.
Many people have reported seeing Maria in one place when in fact she was in another. During the taping of an interview with Maria, I had asked her a question and had asked her to pray for a person I had known who was in a very severe car accident.
Maria, this isn't really part of our interview, but I have a question. It's about a friend.
Yes.
He's back in the States. He was in a bad car accident, and he's paralyzed.
I will go to him. Where does he live?
5, maybe 10 kilometers from my home.
Please, stop your camera. You will have a problem with your tape.
Keep rolling.
Your friend is in a dark room. He is drinking some tea, and he is wearing a blue shirt. I am taking his hand, and I am lifting him up.
When this incident was over, my cameraman was very skeptical that anything at all had happened. So when we got back to the hotel room, we called to the United States, called that person, and to his surprise as well as mine, described in detail exactly what he was wearing and exactly what had happened.
One of the extraordinary gifts that the Virgin Mary reportedly bestowed upon Maria Esperanza, the gift of healing, may have been witnessed by a young couple who gave birth to a very sick child named Ryan.
Gave birth to a little boy. Our sonograms were normal, and we had a big surprise. The little boy came out with spina bifida myelomeningocele.
At the base of his spine, in the center, was his spinal cord, open like an open book, exposed to the air.
I was devastated, really devastated. To see that little boy, and then not knowing, you know, would he walk? You know, what kind of a life would he have?
Medical doctors offered little hope, so the Hulicks went searching for a miracle.
Here I had this little boy with all of these complications, and I wanted to go and hopefully see Maria Esperanza, ask for her prayers and her advice, and then take it from there.
Ryan was 2 years old when the Hulicks made the pilgrimage to Venezuela in search of a cure. During the long bus ride into the countryside, the Hulicks met a family therapist named Marilyn Bakeland.
What I saw was a very placid, sweet little child of 23 months who obviously had spina bifida. He wasn't moving. His eyes were not focused, slightly crossed eyes. Right away I'm thinking, this was the trip that was going to cure their baby. They had such faith in this. I thought, oh, I hope they're not disappointed.
When they reached the Esperanza home, the Hulicks joined with the throngs of hopeful pilgrims. Waiting for them was an urgent message from Maria.
Mother Esperanza knew we were there. She said to her daughter, tell them that already I'm sending out my assistance to them, and that already all of his cells are changing, his blood is changing, the bones are changing, everything is already beginning.
The hour had come when Maria Esperanza was to take little Ryan into her arms.
She took him and she prayed with him and she ran her hand all over him. And I realized that Jesus had already begun the healing before she even touched him. She said he's been set free at last, set free.
It was on the bus ride home that the Hulicks claimed to have witnessed a miracle.
We were on the bus going back to Caracas, and Ryan immediately showed a much increased strength. It was totally amazing.
It was as if someone had waved this magic wand, and this baby went from a retarded, placid baby to a normal two-year-old. There wasn't any doubt in my mind. This baby was cured.
You could see it in his eyes that he had just been set free from this condition that he had been born with. And within the shortest amount of time of coming home, he was walking. And now he's just all over the place. He's doing great.
Of all the gifts Maria Esperanza claims the Virgin Mary has given her, the most profound is perhaps the gift of prophecy, because Maria says the Virgin has issued warnings for the future of mankind.
The Virgin has told Maria this is the hour of decision for mankind, that a very serious moment is approaching soon. She fears that we are on the doorstep of a global war. When you least expect it, be very careful, for she fears that the Soviet Union may try some sort of attack. She warns about new diseases and plagues that will kill in a matter of days instead of a matter of years. And we are at a serious turning point. She says we face a lot of turmoil and perhaps catastrophic events, but in the end, the world will be a better place and it'll be a great spiritual reawakening.
As reports of healings, apparitions, visions of a dangerous future and bilocation, being in two places at the same time, as these reports swirled around Maria Esperanza in Venezuela, another man far off was suffering in a brutal prison. His alleged crime was being a Catholic, his sentence death by freezing. It seemed only divine intervention could save him.
Exiled from his native Ukraine, living now in Toronto, Canada, he claims to hold the secret to hundreds of divinely inspired prophecies. Visionary and mystic Joseph Terelia.
I am
an instrument in God's hands. And there are a lot of things that I don't understand.
Today, living in freedom, Joseph Terelia appears to be an ordinary family man content to while away the hours painting. But a closer look at his art and his life will reveal the anguish and triumph of a modern-day prophet. Author Michael Brown.
Joseph Terelia is a truly remarkable mystic, as well as a martyr. I mean, he never died, but he certainly suffered long and hard, 20 years in the Soviet prison system for being a Catholic activist in the dark, cold days of communism.
Joseph Terelia's odyssey of seemingly miraculous survival, prison escapes, and reported encounters with spiritual beings began the day he was thrown into prison at the age of 19. Dr. Roman Krutsky.
The reason he was placed in prisons was because of the violation of the Soviet code prohibiting the practice of religion. In fact, all forms of religious activity were totally abolished. The churches were desecrated in many ways. In some cases, they used them as outhouses. They would convert some of them into museums.
Hundreds and thousands were the priests and nuns who were actually executed for their religious activities. So it was a tremendously trying time.
Trapped inside the monolithic Soviet prison system, Joseph had two roads to freedom: renounce his religion or escape.
Joseph successfully escaped from Soviet prisons 9 times.
He was relentless in finding his freedom. I think one of the greatest miracles of his life is the fact that this man was never executed. They never did kill him. They tried a couple times, and they certainly tortured him. He was put into cells that were, there wasn't even enough room to move his knees when he sat down, cages that were cold, given only bread to eat.
They found it very hard to physically control him. They repeatedly tried to break his spirit by physically damaging him. So his hands were broken 5 times. They tried to dispose of him by putting him into a room with several murderers who were armed with knives. They slit the veins in the back of the legs and just left him there. Fortunately, a guard saw this happening and he managed to get him out before he was dead.
Eventually, Joseph Turellia's time ran out. Prison officials had had enough.
They decided to kill Joseph by putting him in what they called a freeze cell. It was a cell where they piped in the cold, frigid Russian air. This is 100 miles northeast of Moscow.
They put me in the cell. They took away my coverings. It's hard to describe how cold it was. My eyebrows became heavy. The ends of my hair began to hurt.
At one point, he got up so he could get his head near this light bulb that was hanging from the ceiling for the warmth, because everything was so cold.
I pushed my head up against the light to try to heat my head. The guard there saw what I was doing and he switched off the light.
Death was imminent. It seemed Joseph was about to meet his maker.
The physiology of his body was following its normal course. So he lay down on the cot, body now very, very numb, and his eyelids were literally at this point frozen together. He couldn't open his eyes. As he was going through this, he was praying his final prayers, asking for the Blessed Virgin to help him in this hour of travail.
Joseph claims his prayers were answered and his life forever changed.
At this very moment, I felt an intensive light shining into the cell, and I couldn't raise my eyebrows, but I felt a light surround me and warm me.
He opened his eyes, and there before him was a beautiful, luminous woman whom he took to be the Virgin Mary. She said, "You have called for me, and I have come."
Solitude and goodness penetrated from her.
She began to speak to him and to give him prophecies about the future, warning about a great war that may occur between Russia and China and surrounding countries. She was showing him a map of the Soviet Union and fires breaking out there.
In the meantime, the prison is in an uproar. Guards rush in, trying to make sense of this tremendous light. And as they opened the door of his cell, the light disappeared.
They were stunned. See this man alive. He should have been frozen to death. They were equally stunned to feel the warmth, the heat in that cell. And they accused him of using yoga and all this other stuff. And he said, "No, I was visited by an apparition of the Virgin Mary."
Joseph was placed in a psychiatric hospital for observation, but he was far from crazy. He claims he'd forged a permanent connection with the supernatural. A connection that made him a conduit for prophecy and brought him renown throughout the world. Joseph still had years to spend behind bars, but he used his time painting and to secretly orchestrate a Ukrainian human rights movement.
I was quite well known throughout the world. President Reagan, President Mitterrand spoke in my defense.
After surviving 23 years of misery for refusing to renounce his faith, Joseph Turellia was released from prison. But his journey wasn't over.
He was expelled from the Soviet Union because he was engaged in anti-communist activity with the Catholic underground, with the Christian underground in general. He also worked with oppressed, persecuted Jews. And so they wanted him out of the country, and they exiled him to Canada.
It wasn't until he reached the West that the world learned of the magnitude of prophetic visions Joseph claims were given to him by the Virgin Mary. Joseph Tirelia's spiritual director, Bishop Roman Danilak of Toronto, Canada.
He spoke before the joint houses of the Senate and of Congress, with people at the Pentagon and the White House itself.
He has seen the Pope more than 36 times. 200 prophecies of Joseph have been released by the Vatican, and his visions are essentially apocalyptic in nature.
There will be a great flame or fire in southern Russia. A person will appear called Vladimir. He will call on Russia to destroy Israel.
He has spoken of the San Andrea Fault and the Pacific Coast going to the brink.
The southern parts of the states and the coast of California, there will be earthquakes, and it will sink into the water, or be covered by water.
Joseph warns us that even though we may think things are peaceful, even though things may seem to be going very well in places like the Soviet Union or China, to watch out, because they could be powder kegs that are ready to explode.
In my mind, there is no question that the apparitions taking place in many places of the world are valid. They are things that science cannot explain, and certainly cannot be explained away by labels of mass hysteria.
Just as the icy cold was about to take his life, Joseph Tirelia claims an ethereal glowing woman saved him with warmth. He survived 23 years in a Soviet prison camp with 9 years in solitary confinement and continuous unimaginable torture. However, if his prophetic visions of our future are true and they go unheeded, the worst may be yet to come. Nostradamus may be the most well-known, but throughout the history of man, many other prophets have surveyed the future. And from this chorus of minds comes a collective voice, warning that devastation may be coming our way.
H.G. Wells was an anguished, almost biblical prophet, torn between two visions, one of salvation and one of doom. He was obsessed with the future, so much so that he invented a machine to take him there, a time machine. Some of what Wells saw as he peered into the future aroused and excited him. Much of what he saw filled him with horror. Writing at the end of the last century, he pioneered a new kind of fiction, science fiction. But it was as a prophet, a futurist, a traveler through time that he really made his mark. Forecasting the coming century so vividly and so well that he became known as the man who invented tomorrow. Wells was an amazingly accurate prophet in things both big and small. Everything from superhighways and overcrowded cities to computers and television. Professor Gary Westfall.
He did have a good imagination for envisioning little things that might improve people's lives, like a modern video cassette player, so that instead of reading novels, people watched them in their homes, and babble machines that told them the news, very much like modern radio.
Wells' most remarkable forecasts, however, had to do with war. He virtually invented tanks, or land ironclads, as he called them, describing them so vividly that he claimed a patent on them during the First World War. And Wells, writing in the era of the horse and buggy, forecast the military use of planes, along with the horror they would bring to modern warfare. Professor George Slusser.
Wells was fascinated with what would happen if you would bomb cities. Air warfare means it all. Lines and boundaries are down. You can go deep into an enemy country, bomb its cities.
not only destroy military targets, but you can also attack civilian targets.
Now the bomb was going to drop on your living room, and you could get killed. There was no front anymore. When you had airplanes, the whole country was part of the battle zone.
Wells made his most startling prediction about modern war in 1911, when he forecast a new kind of weapon, an atomic weapon.
He was the first to really envision fully atomic bombs, and he saw them getting out of control and being used to such an extent that they virtually devastated the world.
Wells predicted that the bomb would be made of uranium and used to destroy cities. As he said, in the middle decades of the 20th century.
H.G. Wells fully believed that the human race was capable of destroying itself unless something radically dramatic happened to change things. There was like a preset course that humanity was on, which would lead to perhaps not only the death of humanity, but the death of the world itself.
Wells' last book of prophecy was The Shape of Things to Come. His final vision was dark, but hopeful, full of untold violence, but also the possibility of enlightenment and change. Writing in 1933, Wells predicted an apocalyptic world war.
All of the cities and all the infrastructures and everything are destroyed, and so what you're going to get are little pockets of surviving humanity. Feudal societies, basically, enslaving their peoples.
But out of this, Wells prophesied a new consciousness would emerge, spearheaded by a visionary elite that would take control of the weapons of war and create a world state.
These airmen come and they stop this fighting. I mean, they're able to pacify the people and to lead them, literally, to a new world where they build a new state of technological wonders.
By the middle of the 21st century, Wells envisioned a peaceful world, liberated from old hatreds and adorned with scientific marvels. Wells' most far-fetched vision, of course, was time travel itself. Amazingly, here too, science has begun to bear him out.
There are a lot of scientists today who are pondering the problem of time communication. In other words, communicating with the past through faster-than-light particles.
Apparently, Einstein's theory of general relativity does allow for the creation of a time machine. And one physicist has worked out a fairly detailed scheme for doing it. It does seem to be possible.
Almost a century ago, H.G. Wells wrote The Time Machine. In this story, he traveled 800,000 years into the future and saw a terrible world in which the descendants of the working class were literally eating the descendants of the upper class.
They became cannibals in the sense that these beautiful people that are on the upper world are their cattle. Quite simply, they're raising them in order to eat them. What Wells, as time traveler, saw as a beautiful utopian world first turns out to be a nightmare world.
The nightmare became worse when Wells zoomed further into the future, 30 million years further, and he caught a glimpse of a dying planet, breathing its last under a huge red sun.
The Time Machine still remains a classic work because its prediction is still very accurate in terms of scientific theories. The heat death of the universe is still very much the end of all things.
Wells was always convincing when he wrote about doomsday, but he didn't think disaster was inevitable.
He expressed very strongly the belief that the human race could survive and could improve itself. Wells did not seek to be a prophet. He was not writing in order to predict the future, but to change the future.
Wells himself had to struggle to stay optimistic as he saw some of his nightmare predictions come true. The bomb, in particular, pushed him toward despair. Near the end of his life, he was asked by a friend what he wanted as an epitaph. Wells replied, "Damn you all, I told you so." Of course, he did. Wells had been telling the world about the future since he dreamed up his time machine 100 years ago.
It's an odd fact that one of H.G. Wells' earliest books was about a time machine, and so many of the things he wrote about later on seemingly came true. So why are we so skeptical about a time machine?
The story of time travel reads like a fable. A tale of desperate wartime experiments may be linked to a death in a lonely park in the year 1959. The secrets now known as the Philadelphia experiment were almost lost forever with the alleged suicide of one Dr. Morris K. Jessup, author Preston Nichols.
It's really questionable whether or not Boris Jessup committed suicide or was killed, but apparently there are reports that there was two very well-dressed gentlemen seen walking away from the car early in the morning.
Just days before his untimely death, Dr. Jessup had reportedly received a series of cryptic letters written by a retired merchant marine named Carlos Allende.
Carlos Allende was a merchant marine in the Philadelphia harbor when the Philadelphia experiment was tried.
In his anguished notes, Allende spoke of some terrible experiment he'd witnessed on a ship named the USS Eldridge, back during the dark days of the Second World War. Author Andrew Strom.
What the men on the Eldridge experienced is nothing like anybody has ever experienced. Nothing. Because death, I assure you, would have been easier to live through.
Back in the early 40s, as World War II raged across the lands and seas, desperate times called for desperate action. Author Al Beeling.
We were in the middle of World War II, and the German U-boat fleet was having a field day, sinking 50% of the shipping going across the Atlantic at that time. And the hope was that by making the ships invisible, both the maritime ships and the Navy ships, they could defeat the German radar and they would not be able to find a target to torpedo.
Allegedly, the ill-fated Philadelphia experiment was the US Navy's first attempt at stealth technology, making a ship invisible to radar.
So this is what they were trying to do, and this is what they did do. They succeeded in it in terms of the actual hardware. The ship became invisible, but the personnel couldn't take the effects. And the effects were unbelievable, phenomenal, and totally unexpected.
Reportedly, the initial research that led up to the disastrous experiment in the Philadelphia Naval Shipyard in 1943 was conducted years earlier by the famed scientists Albert Einstein and Nikola Tesla.
Nikola Tesla, back in the 30s, became involved with a group that was experimenting with the ability to move through the time-space continuum.
The experiment started back in Princeton University in about 1939-38. And as they got the thing developed to where they could make something small invisible, then they got it to an object maybe that big. And that gathered the attention of the government.
The military, because we are at war, wanted to pursue it in their direction, of course. So Tesla had finally come to the same conclusion that Einstein did, which was that this technology, if developed, would not be used for the benefit of mankind.
As the story is told, the war raged on and the military needed answers fast. So a full-scale ship was outfitted electronically and a test was scheduled.
In 1943, we conducted a dry run. We had the use of domestic animals. Dogs, cats, and we placed them in different metaled cages along through the ship, the USS Eldridge.
They threw the switches. At that point, electric fields and magnetic fields were generated on a wholesale basis, so you got astronomical amounts of energy.
Reportedly, after the power was shut down, sailors boarded the USS Eldridge to find the experiment had run into trouble.
There was a lot of problems with the animals. Radiation burns, and many of them were missing.
Despite the setbacks, it's claimed the Navy's response to the first trial run was full speed ahead. So on August the 12th, 1943, the USS Eldridge, with a full crew aboard, reportedly underwent the Philadelphia experiment. On the ship, the day may have begun as any other, with the crew attending to routine duties. But the countdown had started. The Eldridge was about to become a legend.
They fired this thing up, they got the generators going. When they threw the switches, that's when all the bizarre stuff started to happen.
So we turned it on, and of course, the ship became radar invisible within a short period of time. And to those who were observers on the carrier, as well as a commercial ship known as the SS Furioseth, a merchant ship, it appeared like the tests were going according to plan. But something went wrong at the last minute. And all of a sudden, there was a flash of light. The ship disappeared completely and was gone from the harbor for about 4 hours.
Instead of merely becoming invisible to radar or even the naked eye, legend has it the Eldridge was actually transported through space and time.
We shot it through the time-space continuum. We arced it through.
It literally took off. I don't mean flying. I meant it just plain disappeared into hyperspace. Was there approximately 4 hours and then returned to the place where it had been originally.
Allegedly, a boarding party was dispatched to the Eldridge because something appeared terribly wrong.
There was a greenish sort of haze on deck, not very heavy, sort of like clouds in a way. The personnel were milling around. They were very sick and ill and quite insane.
And some of them had heart attacks. These were young men, but it was that bad.
Some of them were on fire. Some of them looked dead. Some of them were actually part of the superstructure of the ship, literally stuck in the wall.
There were people buried in the deck and in the bulkhead. Their bodies were enmeshed with the steel of the deck. And some just literally walked into nothing, according to some of the reports. And they never were seen again.
The questions linger. Where did the USS Eldridge go when it apparently vanished for 4 hours? Some theories placed it in Norfolk Harbor, 275 miles away, while even more incredible claims suggest that it voyaged 40 years into the future. And what about the missing sailors? One account points to a mysterious incident at a local bar.
A group of sailors, according to the story, boiled out of a back room of the bar. A little research showed the fact that this bar had no back room. They came out of the wall. There was some connection between the Philadelphia experiment, what happened in that bar.
Officially, the Navy denied everything.
They denied that there ever was such an experiment because of the complications involving what happened to these personnel. They couldn't explain it properly. Those died, they said, were lost at sea.
Some believe there's an even more compelling reason that the Philadelphia experiment was kept under wraps. The project was a success. They supposedly built a time machine.
They do not want the public to know they've had access to time travel for over 40 years.
They have the technology today to move back and forth through the time continuum, both past and future. Yes, we can time travel today.
Some contend that time machines are being clandestinely used to forecast our future.
They're taking no chances. The government has been able to view in the future what is going to come down. Now, whether it comes down exactly the way they've seen it, or with some variation, they know there's going to be serious trouble. But they know in general that the future is not cast in stone. It is changeable. It's anybody's guess what may happen.
The events of 1943 are fading into the past. What horrors did the young merchant marine Carlos Allende witness that were to shadow him into old age? And what was in those cryptic letters he sent to Dr. Morris K. Jessop? Did the doctor die because he knew too much? Did he take the secret of the USS Eldridge to his grave? After 50 years, the Philadelphia experiment has become shrouded in mystery and legend.
So, did the USS Eldridge suddenly disappear? Did it fly forward in time? Did it reappear hundreds of miles away? Naturally, the United States Navy dismissed the incident as a wild and crazy myth. They insisted time travel was impossible. They still do. But is it? It circles the Pacific Ocean. And when the time is right, it may unleash earthquakes and volcanoes, such as the world has never seen. Sitting astride the Ring of Fire are Japan, Colombia, and the United States. But nowhere, it seems, is completely safe. And one man may hold the key as to when this ring may ignite.
The Ring of Fire is a long, deep break in the Earth's crust. It forms an enormous loop that zigzags through the Pacific coasts of North and South America, Alaska, Russia, Japan, Asia, and most of the islands of the South Pacific. The name refers to the hundreds of volcanoes and earthquakes that are generated beneath the crust of the ring. Gordon Michael Scallion has a special interest in the Ring of Fire. Scallion is considered by many to be one of the world's leading futurists. Recently, Scallion claims he has experienced disturbing visions warning of future geological disturbances originating within the ring.
The kind of visions that I'm seeing can be described as no less than catastrophic. I witnessed the Japan Kobe quake about 6 months ahead of time. I knew approximately where it was, and I saw the destruction and the damage.
Both futurists and scientists believe tremendous heat is accumulating below the surface of the ring. UCLA geologist John Davidson.
The heat needs to leave the Earth, and as a result, the interior of the Earth is actually convecting. It's a bit like a pan of soup having a sort of frothy crust on it that moves.
Subterranean heat produces geological stress. When this stress is suddenly released, the result can be powerful earthquakes. For years, geologists have struggled to develop a method of forecasting these events.
Earthquakes have just turned out to be, by and large, relatively unpredictable.
But what if you could predict the approach of natural disasters? Gordon Michael Scallion claims he can. Scallion's obsession with the mysterious Ring of Fire began in 1979. One morning, shortly after recovering from a traumatic health crisis, Scallion was startled to discover that he was suddenly able to see vibrant auroras. This new power was just the beginning. Scallion started having visions of the future. Many of these visions involved earthquakes and volcanoes. And in the 15 years since these apparitions began, Scallion has been haunted by recurring images of earthquakes and volcanoes triggered within the ring.
The Ring of Fire is highly active now, and I predict that it will continue throughout the 90s. And we're going to see the birth of new volcanoes.
Scallion believes volcanic activity within the ring is caused by a massive underground river of fiery lava, or what geologists call magma.
What I see is that the magma has been displaced, disoriented. It actually is bulging. And the bulge is being caused by significant ice buildup at the poles, and the equilibrium of the Earth, or the spin of the Earth on its axis, is out of balance. And it's like a wash machine that gets out of balance and starts shaking and shaking and shaking.
According to Scallion, the land above this bulging magma will fracture.
California, it's going to fracture at its weakest point, and then part of it will slide into the sea, and the other part of it will settle down.
Scallion predicts this fracturing will be the first step in a worldwide domino effect. As this chain reaction accelerates, intense tremors from the Ring of Fire could resonate across the United States, all the way to New England.
We're not prepared on the East Coast at all for what I see coming. Boston and Buffalo are two highly seismic areas that I foresee that are going to have ongoing activity.
But what degree of damage could an East Coast earthquake cause? John Ebel, professor of geophysics at Boston College, has spent countless hours searching for an answer to this difficult question.
A study in 1990 for the Massachusetts Civil Defense Agency suggested that
If the magnitude 6.25 earthquake were to occur off of Cape Ann, Massachusetts today, it would probably cause between $2 and $10 billion worth of damage in the greater Boston area.
Scallion anticipates the geological disturbances originating in the Ring of Fire will affect the Earth's magnetic fields, which in turn will cause the climate to shift.
My visions have shown me that the Ice Age was caused by such a case where the magnetic field shifted, and as a result of it, it funneled cold air from the north and the south in the poles and funneled those into new areas. That same kind of a phenomenon is going to occur again this decade. So where it has been cold, it'll be warm.
Scallion's vision of a world turned upside down by nature is nothing new. Strikingly similar prophecies were written over 2,000 years ago.
There is, in the Bible, a phrase that says that there would be 3 days of darkness. And I have seen that vision of the 3 days of darkness. And I believe it's the result of volcanism in the world throwing up so much ash that it literally appears to be night, and it will stay that way for 3 days.
When the light of day finally returns, Scallion predicts the world will view the resurrection of a lost lamb.
We're going to see the reestablishment of an old continent, Atlantis. It will rise in its majority of its landmass from the area around Virginia to the Bahamas.
Scallion believes the ultimate consequence of geological transformation will not weaken civilization, but strengthen it.
We will emerge out of all of these changes as a much better civilization than we've ever had on this planet before. We all want peace. We all want unity. And we can rebuild and come back together as a community.
Scientists believe the Earth was born of fire. If Scallion's predictions come true, the world will experience a rebirth and renewal induced by the rivers of fire that seethe below the planet's surface. One fact is certain. The Earth will continue to move and there will be more earthquakes. What is not known for sure is where they will strike and with how much force.
The cause of death was almost always routine, but not the fact that they came back to life. Ironically, for those who survive a near-death experience, life may never be the same. Some report returning with detailed visions of the future.
4 women, each claimed to have died, and come back to life enriched with bits and pieces of a puzzle which may add up to a prophetic vision of our near future. For Cassandra Musgrave, her odyssey into the hereafter began one bright summer day.
I feel that my near-death experience was a real gift. I feel like it was a real blessing. It really awakened me. I was water skiing in Northern California, and when I fell down by some freak accident, the rope twisted around my left arm and dragged me behind the boat. And I found myself being pulled at very rapid speed and unable to get any air. And my friends, who were goofing off, didn't stop the boat because they weren't paying attention.
As she began to drown, Cassandra recalls entering into a kind of dreamlike state, which she feels was the beginning of her near-death experience.
All of a sudden, I was out of my body, watching myself being pulled along and thinking, this is really incredible. This is quite amazing. On an inner level, I was being pulled rapidly through a very dark tunnel. I didn't feel afraid at all. And all of a sudden, I found myself coming to a wide open space with stars all around, like out in the universe.
It was in this cosmic emptiness that Cassandra claims to have received prophecy.
Basically, I saw that there was a 20-year period from 1992 to 2012 when things would be greatly accelerated on Earth. And how those things will manifest will be by great Earth changes. Earthquakes, floods, tidal waves, great winds. I also saw that there are certain areas that will be particularly affected. The area of the East Coast, New York, which would be a surprise regarding earthquakes. I remember very clearly Japan slipping into the ocean. I was shown that there would be something akin to 3 days of darkness. I don't feel it's from nuclear war. To me, it was more of a feeling of natural earth disaster with smoke from volcanoes that simply block the sun. We're all going to be on a roller coaster ride, and yet it's not forever. If we have darkness for 3 days, it will pass. We will always have the light.
As quickly as it began, Cassandra Musgrave's brush with death ended.
The moment I came back into my body with a sharp jolt, the boat stopped. One of my friends proceeded to pull me up on the boat, which was hard to do because the rope was twisted around my arm and it hurt a lot. Everyone was really in shock, and it was real clear that they almost lost me.
Another life-after-death encounter reportedly took place within cold hospital walls. Elaine Durham says she was rushed to the emergency room after suffering a stroke in her sleep.
When I got to the hospital, it was not as if I were on the gurney looking up. I was moving, not necessarily walking, but I was at eye level along the right side of the gurney, and I knew that there was a body on it, but I didn't feel any relationship to that body.
Elaine claims her spirit was suddenly transported.
The next thing that I can remember is running across a field of grass. There were maybe 5 to 7 people that were there waiting for me. I realized that the one was my grandmother, and she died when I was 9 years old. And the other one was my husband's Aunt Virginia, and she had just died the previous February.
Elaine says she was jerked back temporarily into the world of the living.
I was back in my body with a body slam, and the defibrillators were above me, you know, getting ready to jolt me again. And they continued to work with me, but when my heart stopped the last time, they pushed me to one side, and I was prepared for the morgue.
Once again, Elaine reported leaving her physical body and entering a spiritual realm of light.
I was pulled into billions and billions of diamond-like sparkles, and I was one of them.
And then, Elaine says, she was shown views of the future.
I've seen the destruction that earthquakes, you know, create. Just watch that Pacific Rim. The Pacific Rim is really going to take a beating, and there's just not any way around it. I had knowledge of icebergs breaking up and moving into warmer waters, and then melting and raising the water table. The water didn't come in and like swallow up all the land. It left areas where there were large islands. America was not destroyed, but we reached that pinnacle where we could have tipped and we could have gone the other way.
Elaine's journey into the future reportedly ended when she woke up in the morgue.
I'm not aware of how I came back. I'm just aware of waking up on that gurney and feeling myself in this cold clay body. The only realization that I had was that I had tears that were going down my face. I had come back to life.
In another case of snatching prophecy from the jaws of death, it was reportedly water that more than once almost claimed the life of a young woman named Jessica Carte.
I was practicing doing backflips off of a low dive and hit the back of my skull. And as I went to the bottom of the pool, I blacked out. And the next thing I knew, I was hovering about 15 feet above my body and thinking, this is really strange. I wonder what's happening here.
Jessica claims she suddenly left this world.
I saw a light tunnel, and these light beams from this light tunnel were lifting me higher and higher, and there was the most profound sense of peace and well-being and love that I've ever experienced in my life.
During this early near-death experience, Jessica feels she was given just a glimpse of prophetic images.
I was shown that there would be a person who would commit suicide, who was essentially an uncle in the family, and that did come to pass at a later point. I was also told that there would be prophetic visions at a future point.
These prophetic visions reportedly arrived a few years later, but for the moment, Jessica says she found herself back at the pool.
The lifeguard had laid me out on the concrete and was doing CPR. As I came back into my body, landed with a thud, I was actually quite angry to be back in my body and away from this light tunnel, this whole experience.
Only a few years later, while tubing down a lazy river, Jessica says she drowned once again.
I found that as I was going down and it was all clouded in green, murkish water, where I could feel myself sinking and fading out and knew what was coming next.
It was the life-extinguishing water that Jessica claims brought her face-to-face with glowing light beings, who this time opened the gates of the future.
The light beings surrounded me and filled me with light. I saw them unrolling a scroll before me. It looked almost like an Arabic or Greek text. I was shown earthquakes all along the Ring of Fire in the Pacific. I saw pictures of horror of a one-world government, the return of concentration camps. I saw diseases and implosions of germ warfare. These visions of essential horror were not lasting, that there would come another time of peace, there would come another time of joy and love, and that you and others will be safe.
With that, Jessica remembers coming up for air.
I came shooting up out of the river's depths and began to swim toward shore of my own accord. I was perfectly fine, perfectly healthy, no brain damage, no psychological damage. It all checked out.
Rather than endow her with prophetic images of the future, one woman alleges her brush with death left her with the ability to predict earthquakes.
I was electrocuted by my fish tank when I was attempting to figure out why it was leaking, and found myself suddenly watching my physical body end up on the floor, and it scared me at first.
Near-death survivor, Diane Morrissey.
I wanted to save Diane Morrissey on the floor. I knew that was me. And I saw the phone and went straight to it through both hallway walls and went to pick up the phone, and my hand went through the receiver. I noticed at one point I was at the ceiling in the den where my body was, and I looked down and I could see my dog Tuffy biting my cheek of my physical body, and it didn't change anything.
Then, in a flash, Diane says she was in the presence of a radiant woman.
She was glowing, so was I, and she spoke to me telepathically. This woman was there to help me decide whether I was going to stay dead or come back.
Diane claims she came back and discovered she had gained an amazing ability.
24 hours before a plane crash, my teeth would hurt, and I figured that out first before I figured out the earthquakes.
Just before an earthquake strikes, Diane believes she's warned by a feeling of illness.
This is instantaneous, very strong nausea, and it goes away usually within 5 seconds. If it's about that long, it'll be like a 6 or a 5 point earthquake. If it lasts longer, up to 30 seconds, it's at least a 7 or higher. For the Northridge one, I was playing cards with a couple of friends, and the nausea hit me.
Diane's friend, Patty Pascal, was there playing cards.
She got nauseous, and she got up and left the table, and came back a little while later and sat down and told us that there would be a major earthquake soon, probably within the next 48 hours. And sure enough, it was.
If anybody would have told me any of this stuff could even happen, I'd know they were a nut. I wouldn't have believed them.
They are four women with four accounts of crossing the boundary between life and death. Could this passage to the afterlife also be a route to prophecy?
There could be a logical explanation for the near-death experience, or a plausible theory to show how a person can predict an earthquake a continent away. But does everything have to be logical or plausible?
They were the first Americans. They lived close to the land, at peace with nature, attuned to the winds of prophecy. Long before the white man set sail for the New World, Native Americans apparently received warnings of what the fates had in store for them. Throughout the ages, Native Americans have depended upon the bounty that the earth, their mother, gives them. They say they are connected to her spiritually.
Recently, they say, she has shown them signs she is in great distress. And they warn that an angry Mother Earth may cleanse herself of all man's evil during a future time called the Great Purification. A member of the Mohawk Nation, Jake Swamp.
There will be a great noise. It will shake up the whole world because it will be so loud.
Hopi elder Grandfather Martin and tribe member Emery Holmes.
We want to warn the people about what's to take place here, the purification of how it will eliminate a lot of people here.
Spokesman for the Innu people, Thomas Dostow.
The warnings are that unless we as a human being stop violating this earth, stop destroying this world that we live upon, the Creator will allow the forces of nature to take their way and purify themselves.
Some Indian prophecies may have already come to pass. It's believed Native Americans foresaw the Europeans' arrival. They may also have predicted the white man's desecration of their sacred Mother Earth. Historian Paul Hutton.
It's remarkable when we take a cold, hard look at the prophecies of the great Iroquois peacemaker in the East, the Cheyenne religious prophet in the West, and we see how each predicted the coming of the white man, how each predicted a great struggle, how they could foretell that the land would be ravaged, that the new people would not only have no respect for the Native Americans themselves, but no respect for the land.
Though Indian prophecy varied from tribe to tribe, nearly all Native Americans were in agreement that the arrival of settlers meant a death sentence for their people. A great Iroquois leader may have predicted this slaughter in a symbolic prophecy. Author Scott Peterson.
The prophecy of the red and the white serpent was passed on to us from Daganoweda, the founder of the Iroquois League. And it tells of a tremendous fight between the red serpent and the white serpent.
The red serpent is said to represent the Indians, a white serpent, the settlers. Author and shaman Robert Ghostwolf.
The Indian people would meet a white serpent, and the white serpent would come to their land, and he would befriend them, and he would be helpless and weak, and they would take him in, and they would nurture him, and they would feed him, and they would teach him the ways of this land. And then the white serpent would grow in power and grow in strength. And the white serpent soon would dominate them and get into power contest with the very people who nurtured him.
Another great Native American prophet, a man called Sweet Medicine, actually described the conquerors and their devastation.
Sweet Medicine brought the sacred arrows to the Cheyennes, gave them their unity as a people, and left them with a prophecy of the coming of strangers from the east, of bearded men who would destroy the buffalo, who would destroy the Cheyennes' way of life. And as the Cheyennes lost their connection with the land, with the buffalo, and with nature, that they would be destroyed as a people. It's one of the darkest predictions and the truest predictions ever made by an Indian prophet.
According to some researchers, Native Americans were united in their belief of these prophecies. Now, years later, the Indians are uniting again.
Indian spiritual leaders are joining together in their warnings about the misuse of the earth.
Many Indian leaders warn another prophecy is about to come true. It's called the Great Purification, and it dates back to the American Revolution. A young Indian chief named Handsome Lake was near death. He claimed visions were revealed to him from the spirit world.
He said, in the future, this is when you will notice, as you looked up onto the top of these trees, that you will find that they are only dead sticks. Your people will go to the water's edge. All they will see is that the water is muddied and dirty.
Many believe these prophecies have already come to pass. They fear the great purification will begin when this last prediction is fulfilled.
There will be a very dark cloud. It will prevent the sun from coming through, and it will hover over them for a long period of time.
This prediction is similar to the biblical 3 days of darkness.
And even scientists believe volcanic eruptions may one day block out the sun.
Native Americans throughout the Americas see a lot of the same signs of the approaching purification. Those include the dying off of the animals, the skies which are no longer fit to breathe, the water that is no longer fit to drink. All Native Americans are warning us that our abuse of Mother Earth has to end.
No one knows for certain when the purification will begin, but some Native Americans feel they have been given special warning.
We had heard through the spiritual elders, through their knowledge, the prophecy now is that the world has another 3 to 4 years left before this great purification takes place.
I feel that there is a great change coming in our lifetime. Many people around the world are also saying that terrible things are going to happen in the year 2000.
But this prophecy of purification is not without hope. A great Indian leader, Chief Seattle, once said, "Whatever befalls the earth, befalls the people of the earth. Man did not weave the web of life. He is merely a strand in it. Whatever he does to the web, he does to himself." The Indians say we are all inescapably tied to the earth. If we can begin to respect and take care of it, they believe we may prevent the purification from happening. But they have warned us the choice is ours.
Maybe we won't have to see a lot of people perish. Maybe we won't have to see that. But the way things are going now, the world is at stake.
An American prophet once remarked, "The most successful prophecies are those that don't come true." The test of prophecy may not lie in predicting the future, but rather in changing it.
From humble peasants of Eastern Europe to aristocratic lords making their mark in Hollywood's golden age, prophets have emerged from all walks of life. Author John Hoag.
There are tens of thousands of people who claim to be prophets and soothsayers. You have biblical prophets, Aboriginal seers of Australia, Native American Indians, prophets like Nostradamus in the 16th century, who have all these different, various people that seem to share a collective vision.
Over 200 years ago, deep in a Bavarian forest, lived a lone cowherder named Stormberger. He prophesied many events which reportedly have been recorded and studied by European scholars.
Stormberger made one of the most remarkable prophecies in history when he predicted the very day that World War I would begin. He predicted this 2 centuries before it happened.
A notorious few were to find Stormberger's predictions so threatening, they censored them. Stormberger apparently went on to predict the Second World War and the ruinous outcome for the nation that started it.
In 1934, many of his statements were destroyed by the Nazis because they considered his premonitions about Hitler too accurate. It apparently angered Joseph Goebbels, the propaganda minister of Adolf Hitler, because many of his predictions are very clearly warning against the rise of Hitler and the war's disastrous results.
The most haunting of this simple cowherder's predictions were his prophecies dealing with our present time, the closing years of this millennium.
Stormberger says, "And after the second great struggle between the nations will come a third universal conflagration, which will determine everything. There will be entirely new weapons. In one day, more men will die than in all previous wars combined. Battles will be fought with artificial guns." Perhaps this is a description of lasers or radar beams or electromagnetic pulse weapons that are replacing our nuclear weapons. Stormberger goes on to say, "Gigantic catastrophes will occur, and with open eyes will the nations of the earth enter into these catastrophes. Everything will become different than before, and in many places the earth will be a great cemetery. The third great war will be the end of many nations."
Years later, and far from the remote forests of Bavaria, another prophet emerged. A British aristocrat who sought fame and fortune in Hollywood gained notoriety for his prophesying of the future.
Kiro was a British count named Louis Hamann. His pseudonym was Kiro because he is well known for his books on palmistry. It means hand in Greek. He lived between 1866 and 1936. And he was something of a Victorian version of James Bond, war correspondent by day, womanizer, and occult scientist by night, and also a spy. He spied for Britain in World War I and had a love affair with Mata Hari.
Most of Kiro's predictions were done by palmistry, numerology, and astrology. He read the palms of the more notable people of late Victorian Europe, including Edward VII and Tsar Nicholas II of Russia.
He is known for his hypnotic powers, and he was proficient in jiu-jitsu and martial arts because he had his own personal prophecy that he might be stabbed by a jealous husband, and that was fulfilled, and he needed to defend himself.
Allegedly, Kiro took full advantage of his hypnotic abilities, sometimes to seduce other men's wives, often right under their noses. Years later, Kiro sought out the bright lights and glamour of early Hollywood. Here, in addition to pursuing a screenwriting career, he read the palms of Hollywood's most famous. Eric von Stroheim, Mary Pickford, Lillian Gish were some of the many who had their fortunes told by Kiro. His true fame arose after publishing a book, Kiro's World Predictions.
It reads like a general history of the coming four or five decades. In it, he accurately dates and predicts Mussolini attacking Libya and conquering it. He foresees the Second World War. He predicted the fall of communism and said that if Russia gets through this difficult time, it will become, again, the preeminent power of the world, even higher than America of today.
Kiro's predictions didn't end in our time. He speaks of future generations.
For the future, he sees a coming chaos, especially in our religious belief systems. He sees the fall of the Mother Church. He also sees prophecies that parallel those about a global warming. The difference with Kiro is that the global warming he sees is just a precursor to the coming ice age.
Kiro died in 1936, but his warnings of the future and possibly his ghost live on. For it's rumored that to this day, Kiro's spirit haunts Hollywood.
Time may have left these lesser prophets anonymous, but their visions live on. The clock is ticking and time may be running out. Prophets have told us that the close of this millennium could be the end of time as we know it. That begs the question, what should we do? Historians tell a story that happened over 1,000 years ago in the first millennium. Prophets warned the people then of impending doom. As a result, the farmers, convinced that the world was coming to an end, didn't see any need to plant crops. The following year, thousands perished from lack of food. Prophecy is a tool. It can help us prepare for the future, or it can become a self-fulfilling trap. The choice is ultimately ours, but we must choose wisely. Otherwise, all these ancient prophecies will have been in vain.